have a thorough understanding of the next couple of slides on the presentation, then you will be able to understand what agonists are supposed to do and what blockers are expected to do in case of dopamine. Now, for the nigrostriatal pathway or for the nigrostriatal tract, the cell bodies of this pathway are in the substantia nigra, as you already know. And substantia nigra in the midbrain, in the pars compacta. Their output is in the striatum. And what happens over here is there is loss of dopamine or dopaminergic neurons, and the imbalance with the acetylcholine, that is excessive acetylcholine activity, will lead to extrapyramidal dysfunction. That means dopamine antagonists would result in pseudo-Parkinsonism. And at the same time, the use of dopamine agonist would cause dyskinesias. Dyskinesias as in they will be hyperkinetic. Now, dopamine actually is very critical to allow initiation of movements. And if it is critical, its loss is going to result in lack of initiation of movements. And that is what we call as bradykinesia. Conversely, the agonists that cause dyskinesia, which are very hyperkinetic movements, cause the patient to constantly initiate the movement cascade, hence the hyperkinetic dyskinesias of the agonist. That means if you give patients antagonists of dopamine at the level of the dopamine receptors, you are going to end up with pseudo-Parkinsonism. But on the other hand, if you give dopamine agonists, that means they will cause plentiful of dopamine to be released at the level of the dopaminergic neurons, and it will result in dyskinesias. Dyskinesias as in hyperkinetic movements. So this is also why, or this also explains why we use dopamine agonists to fight Parkinson's and why we use dopamine blockers to cause pseudo-Parkinsonism or drug-induced Parkinsonism. We actually don't use it to cause, but that is one of the side effects of dopamine receptor antagonists. Now, a second pathway of relevance that you see on your slide is the mesolimbic mesocortical tracts. The cell bodies of this is situated in the ventrotegmental area. Ventrotegmental area, and the output are located in the limbic system. Now you must know where I'm heading towards. The limbic structures such as your hippocampus that controls your memory, and potentially your hypothalamus that controls certain aspects of your behavior. But what we are actually banking on is the endocrine function of hypothalamus. And then if you talk about the nucleus, we have got amygdala, which is important in the aggressive type of responses that a person shows. Right. Now, there are also mesocortical tracts leading towards the frontal cortex. Now, why are these of importance? Because particularly in the prefrontal cortex, they are the prime spot for drug of abuse. So it is well known now that dopamine causes positive reinforcement. What do you mean by positive reinforcement? It means that dopamine, when it is released into your blood, or when you take drugs that enhance the levels of dopamine in your body, it makes you feel good. It causes you to feel pleasure. That is referred to as positive reinforcement. So any action we do or any chemical we take or we get addicted to causes an increased dopamine in the mesolimbic system. And when it causes an increase in the mesolimbic system, it will result likely in an intense pleasure and a desire to repeat the experience. It is that type of reward effect, that pleasure effect, that we can attribute to drugs of abuse. So addiction in part is explained by increase in the dopamine in the mesolimbic pathway and also in certain repetitive behaviors that are observed in psychosis, particularly in the positive symptoms of psychosis. So what I want to tell you over here is that dopamine plays a major role in cognition. It plays a major role in positive reinforcement. It plays a major role in cognitive functions. And it also plays a major role in controlling the way we perceive stimuli, which is referred to as sensory perception. So the drugs that cause increase in dopamine would potentially be the drugs of abuse, but also drugs that could cause positive reinforcement, and at higher doses, it can induce psychosis. So the next chapter that we are going to deal with, which is antipsychotics, will be to decrease that effects of dopamine. So conversely, a dopamine antagonist would decrease the cognitive function, that is to combat the symptoms of psychosis. That will be dealt in the coming chapters. So apart from this, there are small neurons that leave the medial eminence portion of the hypothalamus and directly stimulate or inhibit certain pituitary actions. Maybe the better known fact of dopamine in endocrine is its inhibitory effect on prolactin. That is your pubero-infundibular pathway. So we learned about the nigrostriatal pathway. We learned about the mesocortical mesolimbic pathway that was dealing with the psychotic disorders addiction. It was also dealing with the when dopamine levels increases, it leads to positive reinforcement and also cause psychosis. And when you give dopamine antagonists, it will lead to a decrease in the cognitive function. That was about the mesolimbic. Moving on to the tuberoinfundibular, the most primary effect that dopamine causes on the endocrine physiology is that it causes a decrease in the prolactin levels. It causes such a decrease to the extent that dopamine agonists are actually used in hyperprolactinemic states. Prolactinomas are the most common type of pituitary adenomas. So if you have got a patient with pituitary adenoma and resulting in hyperprolactin formation, you use dopamine agonists such as your pergolide. And that helps in decreasing the levels of prolactin. Shutting down of prolactin in such cases of adenomas would be a good move to prevent the effect of high prolactin. Dopamine blockers, on the other hand, are expected to cause too much prolactin to be used. So in a male, it will result in gynecomastia, and in a female, it may result in amenorrhea or galactorrhea. So this is about the tuberoinfundibular pathway. Now, apart from prolactin, dopamine also has a hold on the growth hormone. It causes a decrease in the growth hormone. So as a result of which, it is used in acromegaly and gigantism. So remember this, growth hormone and prolactin, it is quite used. Now, another effect of dopamine in a central nervous system is its activation of dopamine receptors in the chemoreceptor trigger zone. And when these are stimulated, it will result in emesis. So the very same stimulation we saw occurring with an opiate analgesic. Now, stimulation results in increased vomiting. So how can we use it clinically? So as a result of which, we have got dopamine antagonists which are anti-emetic, and their anti-emesis property is so strong that it is actually used in vomitings induced by chemotherapy. So that is the importance of these dopaminergic neural pathways. Because once you are familiar with where dopamine acts, it will be quite easy to block the effects of dopamine that will be studying in the case of psychosis. Now, additionally, what we can say over here is that in the hypothalamus, in the hypothalamic region, you have got anterior and posterior nuclei. Now, dopamine in hypothalamus controls temperature like a thermostat. So blocking a dopamine receptor will mess up your temperature regulation, and without the thermostat, you tend to overheat and develop a hyperthermia type of response. Now, apart from that, norepinephrine and serotonin along with dopamine cause anorexia. So that is another effect that I'm talking about, dopamine. It causes anorexia. That means a dopamine agonist will induce weight loss, while an antagonist will cause you to gain weight. Now, this property is dealt with the medial and the lateral nuclei of the hypothalamus. So the anterior and posterior, they deal with the temperature regulation. And when you disturb it, you tend to overheat, go into hyperthermic mode. And when you disturb the medial and lateral nuclei and block the receptors, you tend to gain weight. And if you stimulate them, you tend to induce weight because of anorexia. So dopamine should be known for its effect on movement initiation. That is one. Movement initiation. That is first. Then it has to be for positive reinforcement, giving you that pleasure feeling, that good feeling. Then you get psychosis, which we now, under normal terminology, we call it euphoria. Then as endocrine functions, it causes decrease in the prolactin levels, decrease in the growth hormones. Then it helps in control of temperature. And lastly, it decreases the food intake. And also it has an effect on the emesis. So these are the few points that you have to remember when you talk about dopamine. Let's talk about the dopamine receptors that you have already learned while studying the anatomy and pathophysiology. But for just to recall, dopamine receptors are of the following types. We have got D1 receptors, which are GS coupled. And then we have got D2 receptors, which are GI coupled. D2A receptors are the ones that you have seen, and they are present in the nigrostriatal pathway. And then D2C receptors are present in the mesocortical and mesolimbic pathway. Now this becomes, this D2C receptors becomes prominent when we deal with the antipsychotics, because this is a place where most of your antipsychotics, for example, clozapine, will be working. Now let us talk about the actual Parkinson's disease in detail. Now, this Parkinson's disease, the first thing that I would ask you is a little bit on the background of Parkinson's disease. When do we actually see Parkinson's disease? We see this disease in about 2% of the elderly. We see this disease in about 2% of elderly population. And this is classically a disease of the 7th decade of life. That means when you are about to reach 70, you might go into this particular pathology. 7th decade. And this is associated with significant movement anomalies. It is established that Parkinson's disease results from neurodegenerative changes in the actual dopaminergic pathways of the nigrostriatum. When I'm looking at these changes, there isn't really no familial inheritance to it. Because very little Parkinson's disease is genetic, and there seems to be primarily some chemical injuries from free radical, what we call it as oxidant stress. So those free radicals may simply have come from the chronic exposure to the superoxides of the electron transport chain. Whatever the case may be, every decade of life, you are going to lose a little bit of dopaminergic neurons from the nigrostriatal pathway. The result would be, with the lack of dopamine, you are going to get the first symptom, that is bradykinesia, which is what? A slow onset of movements, which is often exhibited as a shuffling gait, or what we call as festinating gait. Right. Now, it represents the patient trying to start the movement, having a hard time getting it started, and suddenly accelerating in the process of going ahead with the movement. The second signs and symptoms that the patient possesses or shows is muscle rigidity and resting tremors. Now, these are two characteristics in the triad of Parkinson's disease. So if you draw a triangle, at the top, you can write bradykinesia. At the bottom, you may write muscle rigidity. And the third will be resting tremors. So this is a triad of Parkinsonism. Now, all those signs and symptoms tend to be not because of lack of dopamine, which explains bradykinesia, but rather to the increased acetylcholine on the muscarinic receptors. So the effects of muscle rigidity and resting tremors is because of overactivity of acetylcholine on the muscarinic receptors. The increased muscle tone is classically seen or revealed as a cogwheel rigidity. Now, a situation whereby if you take the arm of your patient, you will literally feel the arm very rigid and very tough to actually unfold, as if it was on a crenated wheel. The resting tremor is actually a very slow tremor that is seen only at rest and not to be confused with an intention tremor. Now, where do you see this intention tremor? Let's remember that intention tremors are far more classic of cerebellar damage. An intention tremor would have nothing to do with Parkinson's. Alcoholics or patients who have got stroke may exhibit intention tremors. Now, the pathology that is seen in the patient of Parkinsonism, in effect, results from the imbalance between too little of dopamine and acetylcholine, that is too much of acetylcholine. Right. So there will be too little of dopamine and there will be too much of acetylcholine. So there is an imbalance between the levels of dopamine and acetylcholine. And that is what the pathology tells us. So pharmacologically speaking, the strategy is pretty straightforward. That is, first try and restore the normal levels of dopamine using dopamine agonist or some other drugs that enhance the levels of dopamine within the body. And then let's try and block the acetylcholine activity at the muscarinic receptors in the striatum. So the pharmacological therapy is quite straightforward, and what it tells you that increase dopamine and decrease your acetylcholine. Moving on, this particular pathway gives you a magnified version of the beginning of the indirect pathway in the basal ganglion. Here you see the GABAergic neuron, right, from the striatum, from the caudate putamen, as it is on its way towards the globus pallidus. This GABAergic neuron is inhibitory, and like all the GABA neurons, it is under the control of two receptors. And that is your dopamine receptor and your acetylcholine receptor. Now, D2A, which is GI coupled, and therefore it is inhibitory. And this is your M3 receptor, which is excitatory and GQ coupled. The control therefore comes from dopamine from the nigrostriatal pathway, shutting down the GABA neuron through D2A stimulation. And as we have told, this is GI, that means it will shut down the GABAergic neuron. And the acetylcholine neuron from a local interneuron, from the local neuron in the indirect pathway, it excites the GABA neuron and maximizes the inhibition downstream. So when it is this inhibition of an inhibitory neurotransmitter, which results in disinhibition, the term that we have talked about in sedative hypnotics, that results in starting of movements. Inhibition of an inhibitory neurotransmitter helps in initiation of movements. So you start the movement in the indirect pathway through the dopamine, inhibiting the indirect pathway. And conversely, acetylcholine over here is trying to prevent that movement initiation by overstimulating this GABA neuron through the muscarinic receptors. So the numbers over here actually represent the potential groups or drugs used on that system. The primary drug that we will review is your levodopa. Now, levodopa, actually, if you recall your autonomic pharmacology, it is actually a precursor of dopamine that will cross the blood-brain barrier and whose job is simply to increase in the patient's brain the dopamine production. Otherwise, at number two, we have got dopamine receptor agonists. And what do? They simply are used to activate or to stimulate the D2A and shut down the GABA neuron. At number three, we have got chemicals that are acting indirectly, like your selegiline. And what they do is, they actually inhibit the MAOB enzyme. And that results in increase in the levels of dopamine and preventing its breakdown within the neurons. Over here. Now, lastly, we have got the use of muscarinic antagonist. What we do is we'll try and tamper the imbalance where the acetylcholine is too strongly stimulating the GABA neurons. So what do? We try to block the excitation of the muscarinic receptors. So overall, dopamine drugs are the ones we need to really review right now. Moving on to the first set of drugs that we have, and the drug which is of primary importance is your levodopa. Now, what is the specialty of this levodopa? Levodopa being the primary drug in the is the primary drug in the treatment of Parkinsonism. It's actually the central aspect of your treatment. Whatever drugs we have, they revolve around this levodopa. So this is actually the primary prominent strategy for a patient suffering from Parkinson's disease. So levodopa, first and foremost, is a prodrug. It is a prodrug that is converted to dopamine by an enzyme which is called as aromatic amino acid decarboxylase, or for short, it is AAAD. Right. AAAD is found both in CNS and also in the periphery. And because of the fact that dopamine does not cross the blood-brain barrier, we do not want levodopa metabolized in the periphery of the patient. So levodopa is always given with the chemical carbidopa. And carbidopa is actually a peripheral inhibitor of AAAD. It is actually a non-competitive inhibitor. So if it is a non-competitive inhibitor, what does that tell you about its Vmax? What is the effect of Vmax? It actually decreases the Vmax of AAAD. Now, the purpose of levodopa is to make dopamine in the brain. And when you have high levels of dopamine in the brain, it will be pretty impossible to try and mimic physiology of a nerve terminal. Because when you have dopamine, it will cause initiation of movements. It will cause the skeletal muscles to respond. But the high levels of dopamine will exactly not work in the way in which the physiology physiologically produced dopamine would work. So as such, we would tend to get certain side effects with it. So as such, when levodopa becomes dopamine in your CNS, you will see dyskinesias being the primary side effects with the use of levodopa. Those dyskinesias are going to be often referred to as on-off phenomena or on-off effects. So what is basically this on-off effects, which is your potential two marker? Now, what do I mean by on-off effects? Now, what I mean by this is, so basically, when there is high levels of dopamine, you can imagine that movement cascades will be started and it will be as if you were turned on. As if you have been given a drug that has switched on a patient and that patient is uncontrollably starting movements. So this patient uncontrollably starts movements. It's as if somebody has turned on the switch, turned on this positive switch or the on switch. So that is referred to as starting of movements when dopamine begins to exert its activity. Now, every time dopamine drops, simply because you metabolize and clear the drug, then the patient would be turned off. And when the patient is turned off, what happens is all the effects that are happening, which were initiation of movements and the hand gestures that the patient was doing and whatever he was doing, will immediately be turned off, as if the patient is now dulled. So this is referred to as an on-off phenomena, which is one of the primary side effects of the use of levodopa. So when a patient has been turned off, the patient actually reverts back to his pathology of Parkinson's disease with bradykinesia. Then he will possess, the rigidity comes back, and then there will be resting tremors also. When he is on, there will be a starting of movements, there will be hyperexcitability. And when then he is turned off, he will resort back to its signs and symptoms of Parkinson's disease. So these on-off effects, if you want to minimize, we need to minimize the fluctuations in dopamine. So there is so that there is no major increase and decrease of dopamine all of a sudden. So how do we do that? We do that by using levodopa in conjunction with other drugs to maintain a steady level of dopamine in the brain of your patient. Otherwise, as you increase dopamine in the brain, some of that dopamine will be made available in the mesolimbic and mesocortical pathway. And when it is made available in the limbic system, you have the potential risk of developing psychosis. You have the potential risk of developing hallucinations, schizophrenia type of responses, which are very much a part of side effects of medications of levodopa. So if dopamine enters in high quantities in the mesolimbic mesocortical pathway, you have the risk of developing psychosis. Now this were the central nervous system effects, side effects. Now, dopamine made its way towards the periphery. Levodopa has the right characteristics chemically as a precursor of dopamine to bind to D1 receptors. And let's not forget that D1 receptors in the periphery, in the autonomic nervous system, would be associated with vasodilatation. And when they're associated with vasodilatation, hypotension becomes a side effect. Now, hypotension is always a worry in geriatrics patients, because following hypertension, there could be reflex tachycardias leading to arrhythmias. And if anything, hypertension could make anyone feel very dizzy. And if an older person suffering from Parkinson's disease feel dizzy, he could fall down. And if he falls down, it could result in breaking of a bone. And breaking of a bone, if you are an elderly, could be associated with significant morbidity, simply because of osteoporosis. Now, other possibilities, we know that dopamine in the CNS can bind to D2 receptors in the chemoreceptor trigger zone. And as a result, levodopa can also cause significant vomiting or emesis. by stimulating the chemoreceptor trigger zone. Now, one more point that I haven't put on the slide is that levodopa can also decrease the levels of prolactin. Why? Because it is just a precursor and it's chemically similar to dopamine. So in the tubulo infundibular pathway, it might cause endocrine pathologies leading to decrease in the levels of prolactin. So those are some of the side effects that you have to worry about. So having learned the primary drug, which is levodopa, let us talk about the other drugs that we have. Now, let us talk about the first group, and that is the Capone type of drugs, because they end with Capone. The first is tolcapone and entacapone. Now, these are the drugs that will actually inhibit the COMT enzyme. And if you recall your adrenergic pharmacology, we know that COMT stands for catechol. Catechol is a structure that is common to the neurotransmitters. And O stands for oxygen. Methyl, M for methyl, and T is for transferase. So what this enzyme does is it transfers oxygen and methyl drug, methyl group to the catechol ring. So this is an enzyme group that metabolizes compounds such as dopamine, such as norepinephrine, and such as the neurohormone epinephrine. So when you have drugs that causes an inhibition of this COMT enzyme, it will result in the increase in the levels of the dopamine. So COMT over here will actually convert these chemicals, which is dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine, into their three oxygen methyl metabolites. So for levodopa, it will actually convert it into 3 oxygen methyl dopa. And for, let's say, dopamine, it will convert it into 3-0 methyl dopamine. So this is done by which enzyme? This is done by COMT. Now, what do you want? You want your levodopa levels or your dopamine levels to be increased. So you want certain drugs that can inhibit this enzyme. So the idea here is that these methylated compounds behave as partial agonists, and these things, these structures that I'm talking about. Now, when they are metabolized, these methylated compounds, they behave as partial agonists, and partial agonists at dopamine receptors can behave as antagonists at high levels of dopamine. So the worry would be for the levodopa to become the partial agonist and the partial agonist to compete with dopamine and decrease both the uptake of the drug and the efficacy of the drug in the brain of the patient. So what we really need to know that the mechanism of action of tolcapone and entacapone as a family, and the reason why we use them is to try and prevent that partial agonistic formation. And if you want to be perfect, you may want to know that, like so many central nervous system drugs, since they are lipid soluble, they require high liver metabolism. And if you look at this particular point, you'll find that tolcapone is hepatotoxic. Right. So these are some of the points that are that we have to deal with: tolcapone and entacapone, the drugs that inhibit the COMT enzyme. Now, another drug that will be used in this pharmacotherapy strategy is the drug selegiline. We have also another drug which is called as rosagiline. Now, what does the selegiline do? Selegiline is a selective MAOB inhibitor. And this drug, since it blocks selectively the MAOB enzyme, it will be associated with no tyramine interactions. That is, if you recall, there will be no cheese effect and there will be no hypertensive crisis. just like norepinephrine and serotonin would be. The idea is this, that selectively you have to block the MAOB enzyme, and when it is selectively blocked, it cannot result in increased levels of tyramine. And tyramine, if you recall your adrenergic pharmacology, is a norepinephrine, dopamine, or norepinephrine, dopamine, it is a releaser basically in your adrenergic pharmacology. And when it does that, there are, in the case of MAOA enzyme, it is a releaser and it causes hypertensive crisis. But since it blocks MAOB, we don't have to worry about the hypertensive crisis. Selegiline, it is initially used in the treatment of Parkinson's disease, and it is actually used in as an adjunct to levodopa pharmacotherapy. So what it does is it actually allows the levodopa to convert itself into dopamine, and dopamine will not be allowed to metabolize in the brain of the patient. So just like all the dopamine drugs, its primary side effect would include dyskinesias. Dyskinesias will be because of increased amounts of dopamine at the dopaminergic receptors. Then it can also cause psychosis because of increased amounts of dopamine at the mesolimbic mesocortical pathway, because this is dealing with limbic system. And then a very important side effect that we have, and that is your insomnia. Now, what is the deal with insomnia over here? Why does selegiline cause insomnia? This is an important PG entrance exam. Now, the deal with insomnia over here is that selegiline is actually a drug that is metabolized to amphetamine. Amphetamine, as you already know, it is a psychostimulant. Right. And if it is a psychostimulant, you know that psychostimulants are notorious to keep you agitated. And this agitation will classically result in insomnia in the patient. You know, the patients can become anxious or restless because of this amphetamine. Finally, never forget that if a drug is metabolized to an amphetamine, and imagine what if this patient of yours, he wanted to apply for a job, for a position, and then he had to undergo a drug screen. So, well, guess what would happen? This patient on selegiline, who was receiving treatment for Parkinsonism, would screen positive for amphetamines, for amphetamine use, and would obviously be rejected for being thought of as a potential drug abuser. So you actually might be called in to testify to a judge in a court or in a police station or some other place that, you know, actually this is a patient who is suffering from Parkinson's disease and he has been receiving selegiline, and selegiline, when it gets metabolized, it gets metabolized to amphetamine. And so you have to explain to the legal authorities that this is the case with selegiline. Now let us look at this big diagram over here. And what we are actually trying to do over here is, we are actually trying to summarize over here what we achieve by combining all these drugs in the management of Parkinson's disease. Right. Now here is your blood-brain barrier. Here is your blood-brain barrier, and at the periphery is at the bottom, peripheral system is at the bottom, and the central nervous system is above it. And what you want the levodopa to do is, you want levodopa to cross the blood-brain barrier and to be found only in the CNS. Because if it is moving around in the periphery, AAAD will come and eat it away. So you don't want levodopa to be moving around in the periphery. You want to put it into the blood-brain barrier, into the CNS. So therefore, the metabolism of levodopa in the periphery at all costs must be blocked. So this is achieved primarily by the blockade of AAAD, right? So what do? You give carbidopa. You carbidopa is, you know, imagine it's a vehicle vehicle for levodopa to be carried. These are the tires. It is a vehicle, actually carbidopa is a car that takes levodopa into the CNS. And in the meanwhile, what it does, it will not allow the AAAD enzyme to convert it into dopamine. Because if it gets converted, dopamine cannot enter the central nervous system. Now, the other thing that you have to worry about is that levodopa can now be metabolized to its partial agonistic form that competes with it for the receptors. So what you have to do is you have to give drugs such as tolcapone and entacapone. So what do? They will inhibit this COMT enzyme and will not allow the levodopa to become 3,0-methyldopa. So if I have all these drugs together, then I have only one possibility, and that is for my levodopa to cross the blood-brain barrier and go into the central nervous system. Now it is critical to remember that AAAD in the brain of this patient is not inhibited by carbidopa, or essentially the word peripheral AAAD inhibitor is your carbidopa, right? So meaning carbidopa itself must not cross the blood-brain barrier, because if carbidopa crosses the blood-brain barrier, it will not allow the levodopa to be converted into dopamine. But when inside the central nervous system, we want our levodopa to be converted into dopamine. So what we do, we allow the levodopa to be converted into dopamine. How about for COMT over here? Should I block it? Yes, of course we have to block it, because otherwise in the central nervous system, we would form 3,0-methyldopa. So again, checklist, tolcapone and entacapone should work in the central nervous system also. Entacapone. Right. Now, once dopamine is formed, you don't want dopamine metabolized to its metabolites. So what do? You give selective MAOB inhibitors, which is your selegiline. Right? This is the third drug that I could add to this cocktail. And that the third drug is your selegiline, which is a MAOB selective inhibitor. Now with selegiline now, I prevent the breaking down of dopamine to inactive metabolite. And if you could really do all this, then there is really no doubt that the only thing that is going to be left for the drug to do is be levodopa in the periphery, go into the central nervous system, AAAD makes it dopamine, and then you have maximized the efficacy of your treatment. Now, are these the only drugs used in Parkinson's disease? Well, actually, it's not. We do have certain dopamine receptor agonists also. We have full agonists such as bromocriptine, and the ones we studied earlier, which was pergolide. They are actually some of the oldest prototypes of dopamine agonist. So what is the problem with them now? Why are they being used as a primary set of drugs? Now, these are the drugs that have efficacy, and with efficacy, it means potentially overstimulation of the receptors leading to excessive responses. So the side effects of dyskinesias would be most prevalent because of excessive dopaminergic stimulation. And then if we have excessive dopamine in the mesolimbic and the mesocortical pathway, we would get the symptoms of psychosis in those patients. As such, they are not used in Parkinson's disease as of now. They are actually used acutely to manage hyperprolactinemias. That is the number one use for dopamine receptor agonists. These are full agonists. Right. So they are used in management of hyperprolactinemias. It may be due to postpartum or maybe secondary to pituitary adenomas producing prolactin. And they are also used in acromegaly. They are used in gigantism to suppress the growth hormone secretion. Now, there are other dopamine agonists that are less potent than those old drugs, bromocriptine and pergolide. And these are the agonists that are used in Parkinson's disease. And those drugs are your pramipexole and ropinirole. Now, they have also an additive advantage with them, and that is they are also antioxidants. If you remember the first slide that we dealt with the Parkinson's, I told you that the etiology of Parkinson's disease is that it can occur because of oxidative stress. It can result because of oxidative stress or because of free radical damage to the nigrostriatal pathway. Right? Free radical damage. And as such, we require the use of antioxidants. And what better drugs that have the property of being dopamine agonist and at the same time being antioxidants. So these drugs, they not only support the management of dyskinesias of Parkinson's disease, but actually possibly doing something on the progression of the neurodegenerative changes in the nigrostriatal path. Now, finally, the other half of Parkinson's disease is to combat the excessive acetylcholine activity on the muscarinic receptors. So for that, we have got muscarinic blockers. So let's remember that this is pretty important to do to decrease the resting tremors and the cogwheel rigidity that are observed in Parkinson's patient. So we do require the use of full-time muscarinic receptor antagonists. They do not have much effect on the bradykinesia, which is primarily due to lack of dopamine in the first place. And amongst the drugs that we use to decrease the acetyl function, we have actually atropine-like drugs. Now, atropine-like drugs, if you recall your antimuscarinic pharmacology, you may recall that we have discussed about benztropine. We have discussed also about trihexyphenidyl. Only the other drug that we have added that I would like to add over here is diphenhydramine. Diphenhydramine, if you recall, it is actually an antihistaminic. Now, why are we talking about an antihistaminic in a case of central nervous system for a disease such as Parkinson's? Does it have any effect? Let me remind you that all antihistaminics are pretty strong anti-muscarinic drugs. They are actually atropine-like. So the good thing about diphenhydramine is that it is used, it is available in IV forms and it is used in a hospital setup. Now, coming to the side effects of these drugs, they will be atropine-like. So when I say atropine-like, the first and foremost thing that should come to your mind is decreased secretions. Right. So that means dry mouth. Then you will have mydriasis, right? And this will be with lack of accommodation because muscarinic receptors are present on the ciliary muscles and they are getting blocked. So the patient will have blurred vision, right? Then at the level of the GIT, you will have constipation. Then you'll also have urinary retention. Now tell me that if you have a patient with Parkinsonism, that is quite obvious that the patient will be in his 70s, right? In the seventh decade of life. So what if that patient has had glaucoma? He's bound to have such changes in the eye. Can you give these drugs? No, you can't, because you will exacerbate the glaucomic condition. What if this patient has got benign prostate hypertrophy? Can you give it in case of this? No, you cannot. So you have to be very careful while selecting the treatment for Parkinson's disease in particular patients. Then apart from this, you already know that atropine-like drugs, they have got the characteristic three C's with them. Three C's, which is cardiotoxicity. When I say cardiotoxicity, by that I mean Toxard, which is a very dangerous arrhythmia that can lead to ventricular fibrillations in patient. The other C is convulsions. Then lastly, we have got coma. So these are the three C's that are associated with atropine-like drugs. So this is about the atropine-like drugs that we have discussed. So one more drug that I would like to add over here, which is not actually an antihistaminic or an antimuscarinic or a dopamine agonist, but is actually an antiviral. And this antiviral is actually be found to possess properties of muscarinic receptor blockade. And the drug is amantadine. So it is not the use of amantadine as an antiviral that makes it a drug of importance for Parkinsonism. It is actually the property of muscarinic blockade that makes it one of the most potent drugs for being used in the treatment of Parkinson's disease. So besides that pharmacology of blocking the muscarinic receptors, it also have an additive property of enhancing the levels of dopamine. So it's actually a good thing. It adds it at one step, it is blocking the muscarinic receptors that we wanted, which was one of the primary strategies of pharmacotherapy of this disease. And secondly, it is also increasing the levels of dopamine. So it is actually a good thing. Now, looking at the side effects, since it is a muscarinic blockade, it is bound to have atropine-like effects. That is very obvious. And but what is more striking in the side effects of amantadine is the side effect of livido reticularis. Now, when you try to read pharmacology, you will come across certain drugs that have characteristic side effects. For example, if I say hypertrichosis, you should immediately think of minoxidil, potassium channel opener. So in the same way, we have got livido reticularis, which is actually the pathognomic side effect of amantadine. No other drug is associated with this side effect. So just for an additional point, let me tell you what livido reticularis is. It's not a life-threatening disease, but it's actually a condition that affects both the skin and the vessel. Livido means it makes the skin look extremely pale, and reticularis means the vessels, the veins, they dilate. And they form a purple meshwork underneath the rash. So it is, as I said, it is not a life-threatening situation. It's just a side effect that is characteristically associated with amantadine. So with this last drug of amantadine, we conclude our chapter on drugs for Parkinson's.